Despite the false advertisements about the harmfulness of carbohydrates, the fact is that the recommendation that we have for Americans is that 45 to 65% of the calorie that we need per day should come from carbohydrates. And we do have a variety of carbohydrates, and the important thing is to choose the carbohydrates that are healthy. In this video, we're going to start talking about how our digestive system breaks down carbohydrates, and eventually we get the monosaccharides that we can absorb into our bloodstream. And then we talk about those carbohydrates that our body cannot digest them, and therefore we cannot absorb them. However, it is highly recommended that we add those carbohydrates in our diet. So let's start. Recall from major salivary glands, parotid, submandibular, and sublingual glands, and also the minor salivary glands that we have in oral mucosa, we have secretion of saliva into the oral cavity. And one of the components of saliva is an enzyme named salivary amylase. That's the one that inside the mouth starts breaking down a carbohydrate named starch. For example, we find starch in pasta, rice, bread, potato. And what salivary amylase does, it breaks down starch into smaller molecules such as maltose, maltotriose, alpha-dextrin, which is a shorter polysaccharide. But the reality is that salivary amylase has a very limited time inside the mouth to break down starch. So to be fair, we have to dedicate another place that salivary amylase in that location continues breaking down starch, and that location would be in the fundus of the stomach. So now we move on to the fundus of the stomach. Here we have the fundus of the stomach. Inside the fundus, salivary amylase usually has about half an hour to maximum an hour to continue breaking down starch molecules into smaller molecules. However, please note, when the content of the fundus get mixed with gastric juice, which is very acidic, hydrochloric acid that we have in gastric juice deactivates salivary amylase. So that would be the end of breaking down starch by salivary amylase. In general, we can say that inside the stomach for a limited time, salivary amylase only in the fundus of the stomach can break down starch. And after that, we need to wait till we get inside the small intestine. So chyme from stomach is going to move down eventually through pyloric sphincter into the small intestine. And recall, in small intestine, we receive pancreatic juice. Here we have the long pancreatic duct, which is also called duct of Verson. And also we have the accessory pancreatic duct, or duct of Santorini. And both of these ducts are going to release pancreatic juice, which contains many different types of enzymes, into the lumen of small intestine. One other thing, duct of Verson attaches to common bile duct and form hepatopancreatic ampulla. But in this video, we focus on the enzymes that we have in pancreatic juice. And we know that pancreatic juice is released into the small intestine through both pathways. In pancreatic juice, we do have an enzyme named pancreatic amylase. That's the one that in the lumen of small intestine breaks down starch molecules again into smaller molecules, such as alpha-dextrin, maltose, maltotriose. And the last enzymes that finalize breaking down this carbohydrate, it simply means that these are the last enzymes that they break down the carbohydrate into monosaccharides that we can absorb into our bloodstream through the wall of small intestine, formed by the cells that line the small intestine. The absorptive cells that line the small intestine form groups of enzymes that we refer to them as brush border enzymes. And one of the brush border enzymes of the absorptive cells of small intestine would be referred to as alpha-dextrinase. This is the enzyme that actually starts breaking down alpha-dextrin molecules into individual glucose molecules. And when we get the glucose molecules, that's the monosaccharide that we can absorb into bloodstream through the wall of small intestine. However, it is important to note that in our diet, we also have disaccharides. The well-known disaccharides are sucrose, table sugar, maltose, the type of disaccharide that we find, for example, in beer, lactose, we find lactose in dairy products such as milk, and the absorptive cells that line the small intestine produce brush-border enzymes to break down these disaccharides. So, in short, prior to getting into small intestine, we do not break down the disaccharides. Breaking down disaccharides is limited to the use of brush border enzymes of the absorptive cells of the small intestine. So, for example, a brush border enzyme that these cells produce is referred to as sucrase. That's the one that breaks down sucrose molecule into a glucose and a fructose molecule. And then we absorb glucose and fructose into blood through the wall of small intestine. Another brush border enzyme that we have is called maltase. That's the one that breaks down maltose molecules into individual glucose molecules. So each maltose is broken down into two individual glucose molecules. And also we have another brush border enzyme named lactase. That's the one that breaks down lactose molecule into a glucose and a galactose molecule. And in those individuals that we know them as being intolerant to lactose, they have lactose intolerance, they lack enough numbers of lactase enzyme. In general, the small intestine of these individuals does not produce sufficient amount of lactase. And when we do not have enough lactase, some of the lactose molecules cannot be digested in the small intestine. And if we cannot digest lactose into monosaccharides, we cannot absorb those monosaccharides. So the lactose molecules that are undigested from small intestine eventually move into large intestine. And recall, in large intestine, we do not have enzymes. We actually have bacteria. Those bacteria are going to break down lactose molecules, and one of the byproducts that they produce would be lots of gas, which increases the pressure inside the large intestine. It causes diarrhea and it makes the individual uncomfortable, which we already know these individuals either should go with a lactose-free diet or they add the enzyme lactase to their diet if they have, for example, a dairy product. So that was about those carbohydrates that we can digest and break them down into monosaccharides and then absorb the monosaccharides into our bloodstream. However, it is important to note that there are some polysaccharides, some carbohydrates, such as cellulose, that our enzymes are not capable of breaking them down. And in normal conversation, we refer to these polysaccharides that are made by plant cells as fibers. We have two groups of fibers, soluble fibers and insoluble fibers. The researchers in medical field show that adding soluble fibers to our diet lowers the risk of heart diseases and cardiovascular diseases, help our body to balance the blood cholesterol level much better, and adding the insoluble fibers to our diet adds to the volume of solid waste, so defecation could happen more frequently. But basically, it helps our digestive canal to eliminate waste on time. So, even though those are the type of carbohydrates that we cannot digest and therefore we cannot absorb them into our blood, but having them in our diet would be beneficial.